Hello. My name is Jasenka Borzan. I'm a scientific review officer at the National Institute of Mental Health. Welcome to the first segment of a four-part presentation on the NIH peer review process. This presentation will focus on the general overview of the process and fundamental aspects of submitting an application to NIH. As you may know, National Institutes of Health are composed of 27 institutes or centers, each with a specific research mission, often focusing on a particular disease or a body system. When applying for funding to NIH, your application may be funded by one of 24 funding institutes. The other three centers do not fund extramural research, but have other responsibilities within NIH. Important to notice for this talk is the Center for Scientific Review, highlighted in green here, which serves as the portal for all NIH grant applications and their review for scientific merit. We'll talk about that in more detail in just a minute. First, in order to give you a broad overview of the NIH activities, you can see that in the fiscal year 2021, more than 80% of the $43 billion budget was spent on extramural research grants, on training and contracts. About 11% of the budget funds intramural scientists at NIH across all institutes. However, the largest part, almost 60%, is awarded to institutions supporting individual principal investigators through research projects. So, what does it take to go from an idea to a funded research project? Let's look at the so-called life cycle of a grant application. As a principal investigator, you would write an application and your institution, be it university or institute, or another organization would submit it then to NIH through grants.gov. All applications are then first received at the Center for Scientific Review, more specifically, the Division of Receipt and Referral. From there, each application is assigned to a funding NIH institute, for example, NIMH, and to a specific scientific review group, Center for Scientific Review has the largest number of such review groups and reviews about 70 to 80% of applications received by NIH. However, each funding institute has a review branch as well and reviews applications that are of special interest to that institute. In any case, once the application is assigned to an institute in terms of scientific interest and to a review group for evaluation of scientific merit, the review process is said to have two levels. The first is evaluation of scientific merit organized by a scientific review officer, such as myself. What we do is we recruit a panel of experts to evaluate and score the applications. However, we do not make funding decisions. We only focus on the evaluation of the scientific merit of applications and forward the recommendations about that to the institute council members and program officers at specific institutes. They're the ones who make funding decisions in this second part of the review process. The advisory councils recommend specific applications for funding to the institute director. And then based on those council recommendations, the institute director makes the final funding approval, after which the funds are finally allocated to the respective applicant institutions. And it is at that point that the principal investigator, such as perhaps yourself, receives the award and can begin research. It is certainly not a simple process, but I hope that we can guide you through it with some fundamental information and that will help you if you decide to apply for NIH funding. The first rule of successfully applying for NIH funding is follow the instructions. So begin by following the SF-424 application guide instructions. The link to this guide is included in every funding opportunity announcement or FOA. And also, importantly, Section 4 of every FOA includes application and submission information that states what part of the SF-424 guide are relevant to the FOA and explains any additional application requirements for that FOA. Importantly, the instructions in the FOA supersede the instructions in the guide. For example, the application instructions in the FOA may state to follow instructions in the SF-424, as in some examples on this slide, or may include additional or different instructions, such as different page limitations for some sections or specific requirements about the types of information that must be included in the application. The bottom line is make sure you follow the instructions in the FOA. And just to tell you a little bit about the important staff who are involved in the grant process, I wanted to introduce you to a few names or abbreviations. So an SRO or SRA, you already are familiar with. There are people like myself who organize review meetings and are your primary point of contact after you submit your application, but before the review actually happens. We manage the scientific review by organizing special emphasis panels and recruiting reviewers of appropriate expertise to them. And we're also responsible for generating summary statement reports after each review meeting. SROs can work at the Center for Scientific Review or within review branches of individual institutes. The second person you should know are program officers. Or directors. They work at funding institutes and manage specific portfolios of awarded grants or contracts. They're probably the best first contact at NIH when you are applying for a grant. When you have an idea and you're thinking about applying, the POs can answer questions about the scientific priorities at their institute and how responsive your ideas may be for specific funding opportunity announcements. Once a grant is awarded, program officers are also responsible for monitoring scientific progress on that award. Grants management specialists are equally important in this process. They work at specific institutes and are responsible for the fiscal stewardship of a portfolio of awarded grants. They monitor the financial progress of each award. When you're applying for an NIH grant, applicant institutions have to complete and maintain registration in a number of systems, such as grants.gov, ERA Commons, and System for Award Management. As a principal investigator, you need to be familiar with two of those systems, grants.gov and ERA Commons. Grants.gov is an online portal that's used to find and also apply for most federal grants within and also outside of NIH. It also provides access to all the current application forms. ERA Commons is a system for receiving applications and communicating information about review dates, outcomes of the review, and also awards. Every applicant as a principal investigator must have an ERA Commons account that is associated with their institution or organization. Also, as I mentioned previously, it is institutions or organizations who submit applications to NIH. And in order to do so, every institution must be registered in the System for Award Management, or SAM, and also in ERA Commons prior to submission. The institutions are responsible for completing and maintaining institutional registration in SAM, as well as registering principal investigators in ERA Commons. Applications are submitted using the grants.gov or ASSIST, which means Application Submission System and Interface for Submission Tracking Portals. The NIH applications must be in response to an Open Funding Opportunity Announcement or FOA in grants.gov. There are many ways you can search for Open Funding Opportunity Announcements. One way is to go to grants.gov and search for current parent announcements using the website listed on the slide. You could search for FOAs based on specific scientific topics of interest, or you could decide to narrow your search based on specific institute of interest by going to their website and searching their current announcements. What is important is that you download the specific application package from grants.gov each time that you apply for an NIH grant based on a FOA of your choice. And the reason for that is to make sure that you don't have outdated forms or that you're not missing any new potential requirements in the FOA. So to tell you a little bit about the types of FOAs you can apply for, there are three main categories of funding opportunity announcements at NIH. Parent announcements, or PA, funding opportunities are also called unsolicited or investigator-initiated applications because they're open to broad scientific interests within the scope of the NIH mission. These include many different types of grants or so-called activity codes, like an R01 application, or other research grants, training, and fellowship grants. These applications utilize three standard receipt dates per year. PARs are program announcements with special receipt, referral, or review requirements. These FOAs are more narrowly focused in soliciting applications for a specific scientific topic or area. And they're often reviewed in institute review branches and have special review receipt dates. The third category are RFAs, or requests for applications in defined and high priority or high opportunity areas of science for one or more institutes. These are RFAs, or requests for applications. I will discuss a few important details about these in just a moment. But first, what I would like to do is provide you with a little bit of more information, just a second, about the different types of parent announcements that exist. So as you can see from this table, for example, these are quite broad. They can be R01s, they can be smaller research grants, grants that support conferences or scientific meetings, or small business grants. They can also be training grants like T32s, Ks, or fellowship grants. The full list of parent announcements can be found following the link at the bottom of this slide. An important note again here is that institutes choose what parent announcements they wish to support. So you need to check in the FOA whether your institute of interest is accepting applications for that activity code before you submit your application. Now, a little bit more about the RFAs. As I mentioned, these FOAs are focused on specific scientific interests of one or more institutes. They're typically very specific in terms of scientific goals, desired outcomes, and also application requirements. So it's critical that you read the RFA very carefully before applying. RFAs are shaped in consultation with advisory council members of each institute, and they have set aside funds to support a specific number of awards each year, and they typically have special receipt dates. These FOAs often have special eligibility requirements, submission instructions, and review criteria. Once you select the appropriate FOA and you write your application, you will need to submit it using grants.gov. You can fill out appropriate forms using Workspace in grants.gov. This is typically done in collaboration with your grants office at your institution. And this process generates PDF files for a lot of the administrative pages, like the cover page, key personnel information, budget, and so on. And the main documents, such as the research strategy or bio sketches that you have, are uploaded in the system as separate PDF attachments to the application. As mentioned a few times already, the most important thing is to carefully read and follow instructions in the SF 424 guide, as well as the FOA. So just a couple of more details that I wanted to mention when you're thinking about applying for an application. One of them is, if your project requires a multidisciplinary team of scientists, you may want to consider whether applying as multiple principal investigators might be appropriate for your project. In this case, even though one person is designated as a contact PI, every principal investigator on the MPI team is responsible for the success of that project, although they don't have to devote equal effort. Specific roles have to be clearly defined in that case in the MPI leadership plan, and a conflict resolution plan has to be described as well. Most types of research project grants allow MPI designations, although there are some activity codes that do not, such as career development or K awards or fellowship applications. The second detail I wanted to mention is if you are working in an area that is similar to global health, or you anticipate having foreign collaborators, it is important that you check whether the FOA allows participation of foreign institutions or foreign components as part of the FOA. You can find that information in section 3 of every FOA. And this brings us back to the picture of the grant life cycle. In this first segment, I hope you gained a good understanding of the overall application and award cycle, as well as more specific information about the first part of the process, namely that you as an investigator are writing the idea and preparing your application. And then your institution, by way of authorized institutional official, submits the application to grants.gov. Once submitted, you can actually view your assembled application in ERA Commons. If you notice any errors in the final version of the documents you submitted, you can contact ERA Service Desk for help on how to correct those errors. And additionally, the filled out forms and attachments are electronically validated, and applications with administrative errors are flagged by the system as well. The most important thing again here is that you start preparing your application early enough and submitting it before the actual deadline for receipt. And the reason for that is so that if you notice any errors in your application, you have enough time to revise them and re-upload all of the components again in the system before the receipt date. After that, you would not be able to make any corrections. And with that, I want to thank you for your attention,